Szanowni Państwo, przyjaciele Polityki Insight. Chciałem Was serdecznie powitać na piątej dorocznej edycji konferencji Ryzyka i Trendy. 2019 rok zapowiadał się jako rok przełomu. Jak rozmawialiśmy tu rok temu, spodziewaliśmy się, że niebawem dowiemy się, jak będzie wyglądał nowy porządek. Jedyne, co dziś możemy powiedzieć z dużą dozą pewności, to że wszechogarniająca niepewność jest stałą i będzie nam towarzyszyła w tej nadchodzącej dekadzie. Katastrofa klimatyczna jest faktem. Niewiadomą są jej skala i to, jaki wpływ będzie miała na naszą codzienność. Dziś obserwujemy olbrzymią transformację sektora energetycznego, choć z różnym natężeniem w zależności od miejsca na mapie. Widzimy zmiany społeczne, rosnące ruchy oporu, przede wszystkim młodych. Młodych, którzy oczekują dużo szybszych i poważniejszych działań niż te podejmowane dzisiaj przez rządy i korporacje. Tymczasem Europa jak zawsze wymyśla się od nowa. Innowacyjność to słowo tak zużyte, że aż wstyd je wypowiadać. Z drugiej strony wszyscy wiemy, że jeżeli nasza wspólnota nie sprosta wyzwaniom technologicznym XXI wieku, zostaniemy jeszcze bardziej w tyle w cyfrowym globalnym wyścigu. Spełnią się koszmary o zabytkowym kontynencie, który jest jednym wielkim historycznym parkiem rozrywki dla amerykańskich i chińskich turystów. Tu gra idzie o konkurencyjność naszej gospodarki, o śmierć i życie europejskiego przemysłu. W styczniu USA podpisały umowę wstrzymującą wojnę handlową z Chinami, ale w każdym momencie rozmowy mogą się załamać, a konflikt może wrócić ze zdwojoną siłą. Po zabójstwie Hasema Sulejmaniego udało się uniknąć wojny, ale sytuacja na Bliskim Wschodzie jest bliska wrzeniu. A świat czeka z zapartym tchem na wynik wyborów w Ameryce i początek prawdopodobnej drugiej kadencji Donalda Trumpa. Z kolei w Polsce mamy do czynienia z bezprecedensowym kryzysem państwa. Kryzysem wywołanym niekończącą się reformą sądów, której główne osiągnięcie to skłócenie wszystkich ze wszystkimi, podważenie porządku prawnego i wydłużenie trwania postępowań sądowych. Z ostatnich, wygranych przez PiS wyborów parlamentarnych, praktycznie wszystkie siły polityczne wyszły osłabione. A wynik wyborów prezydenckich nie jest przesądzony. Ta niepewność, o której będziemy rozmawiali przez cały dzisiejszy dzień, to naszym zdaniem zapowiedź dekady niestabilności. Ten brak pewności dobrze współgra z innym znakiem naszych czasów. Żyjemy szybciej, w świecie, w którym czas i uwaga skróciły się do koniecznego minimum. W takim świecie wartością nadrzędną jest adaptacja. To wymusza zmiany myślenia o przyszłości, zmiany zachowań i prawdopodobnie nadciągającą wymianę klasy politycznej, żeby nie powiedzieć elit. I z tą niepewnością, o której dziś będziemy rozmawiać, mierzymy się na co dzień w Polityce Insight. A jest to możliwe dzięki Wam, naszym odbiorcom, słuchaczom, czytelnikom. I przede wszystkim dzięki naszym partnerom, którym w tym miejscu chciałem podziękować. Partnerem głównym konferencji Ryzyka i Trendy 2020 jest po raz kolejny Orange Polska. Partnerami wspierającymi są Facebook, IKEA i UPC. Dyskusje okrągłostołowe zorganizowaliśmy dzięki naszym przyjaciołom z ambasady Holandii, GMF US i dzięki wsparciu firmy Lighthouse. A teraz chciałem Państwa zaprosić na pierwsze wystąpienie dzisiejszego dnia, na wystąpienie pani minister Jadwigi Emilewicz, która mam nadzieję odpowie na pytanie, czy rzeczywiście klimat zmienia wszystko. Pani minister, zapraszam.
Panie redaktorze, szanowni państwo, przede wszystkim dziękuję za zaproszenie do udziału w Polityce Insight. To nie pierwszy raz, kiedy mogę być państwa gościem i chciałabym bardzo serdecznie podziękować za to, że ten barometr zmian Polityka Insight ma nieustająco włączony i daje nam do myślenia codziennie o poranku, kiedy sprawdzamy, czy naprawdę wszystko to, co nam się wydaje, jest tak, jak jest. Także za to dziękuję i dziękuję za tę konferencję. Ale czy odpowiedź na pytanie nie jest prosta, panie redaktorze? W tym swoim otwierającym wystąpieniu rzeczywiście zarysował pan mało optymistyczny krajobraz, który nas czeka, ale trudno nie zgodzić się z tym, że niepewność jest pewnie tym słowem, które z całą pewnością możemy powiedzieć, że będzie i towarzyszy nam w ciągu ostatnich lat i zapewne będzie znakiem rozpoznawczym jeszcze przez najbliższych kilka. Ta niepewność, która wiąże się z sytuacją globalną, powiedzieliście i o o niej także pan redaktor wspomniał. Napięcia na linii Stany Zjednoczone, Europa, Stany Zjednoczone, Azja, Chiny przede wszystkim, ale nie tylko. Zmiana, naruszanie porządku WTO, budowanie relacji wzajemnych na być może innych zasadach. Na razie nie wiemy na jakich. Nie musimy mówić, że tematem numer jeden w mediach europejskich od minionego piątku jest Brexit, który w piątkowy wieczór na wyspie świętowany był, fetowany, tak? Bo to wiemy nie tylko w gazetach, nie tylko w mediach, ale w takim codziennym życiu. Natomiast to, jak będzie wyglądać Europa po Brexicie, tego jedyne, co możemy powiedzieć na pewno, to, że nie wiemy. Teraz czekają nas intensywne prace do końca roku. Naszą intencją, intencją Polski jest, aby utrzymać Wielką Brytanię jak najbliżej, jak najściślej, w jak najściślejszych relacjach z Unią Europejską. Jesteśmy przekonani, że jest to naszym wzajemnym interesem, europejskim interesem, że dzisiaj, kiedy te napięcia globalne powinny skłaniać nas do debaty nad tym, jak utrzymać poziom konkurencyjności Europy w świecie globalnym, my jesteśmy nieco wytrąceni z tej dyskusji, bo za mocno koncentrujemy się na naszych wewnętrznych sprawach, no chociażby właśnie takich jak te związane z Brexitem. Niepotrzebnie stawiamy sobie mury, które nie idą w zgodzie, nie idą w parze z podstawowymi swobodami, na jakich ufundowana jest wspólnota europejska. I mówię tutaj o swobodnym przepływie towarów i usług, o tych elementach, które są największym być może sukcesem procesu integracji. Ale dziś podczas Polityki Insight wiele dyskusji będzie się toczyć wokół klimatu i o klimacie będzie też mówił minister odpowiedzialny za gospodarkę. Mogą Państwo zapytać dlaczego? Dlatego, że jest to z całą pewnością temat horyzontalny. On wykracza poza zainteresowanie jednego resortu. Ochrona środowiska to dzisiaj nie jest moda, to nie jest maniera, no ale jest to nasz pewien wspólny cel, który staramy się osiągnąć, a aby go osiągnąć, musimy współpracować ponadsektorowo. I na pewno tutaj minister Michał Kurtyka, który odpowiada w nowym rządzie, w samym jakby semantycznie to także ma znaczenie, że powstało Ministerstwo Klimatu, to także pokazuje, że my mamy świadomość, jakie to jest ogromne znaczenie. I to odwołując się, może zaczynając najpierw od tego, dlaczego może zdziwienie budzić, że rząd z natury o proweniencji prawicowej, konserwatywnej mówi z dużą odwagą i śmiałością i z dużą odpowiedzialnością o klimacie. To jak wielokrotnie już przypominałam, to znaczy, sięgamy do korzeni. Myślę, że zgodzimy się wspólnie co do tego, że ideologie ekologiczne, pacyfistyczne końca lat 60., początku lat 70., które powstały na gruncie takiego ruchu antyglobalistycznego, no, wyczerpały swój potencjał. To znaczy one nie spełniły oczekiwań, jakie same przed sobą stawiały. Polityka nie stała się, czy też gospodarka nie stała się bardziej przyjazna dla środowiska. Być może dlatego, że ta odpowiedź, która przychodzi w minionych 20 latach, jest znacznie bardziej wiarygodna. Odpowiedź, która nie wyrzuca człowieka z centrum, czy gdzie po prostu człowiek jest w centrum i dlatego, że jesteśmy w centrum, dlatego, że Ziemia jest antropogeniczna z natury rzeczy, to właśnie dlatego to powrót do odpowiedzialności człowieka za otoczenie staje się tak istotny. I sięgając do pism i źródeł, które gdzieś tam u podstaw tego myślenia sięgają, czy też ten nowy stan opisują, to warto wspomnieć zmarłego niedawno Rogera Scrutona i jego zielony konserwatyzm, gdzie bardzo jasno mówi o tym, że jeśli chcemy na poważnie zmierzyć się ze zmianami klimatycznymi, to musimy wrócić do tego, co lokalne. To znaczy, że ludzie na ziemi, ludzie w Polsce, ludzie w Europie, wszędzie muszą poczuć, że jest to ich wewnętrzna potrzeba, bo inaczej polityki programowane odgórnie nie zdadzą egzaminu. No i to poczucie odpowiedzialności, pisze o tym także ostatnio Chantal Milon-Delsol, a także wcześniej, jeszcze w latach 80. w Centesimus Annus Jan Paweł II, który przywraca, zaczyna mówić o tym, co to znaczy czynić sobie przez człowieka ziemię poddaną i o tym odpowiedzialnej obecności człowieka na świecie. To, czy mamy nie mnie tutaj dyskutować o tym, jaki jest wpływ człowieka na zmianę klimatu, wydaje się, że dzisiaj te argumenty dotyczące antropogenicznych źródeł zmian i tych gwałtownych następstw są jasne i że epoka takiego nadmiernego korzystania z zasobów naturalnych powoli przechodzi do historii. Epoka też, żeby była jasność, która rozpoczęła się w XIX wieku, w której my wtedy jako Polska nieobecna na mapie Europy nie korzystaliśmy, czy też bynajmniej w tych głównych trendach, to nie my masowo wycinaliśmy wówczas lasy, to tak jak to wydarzyło się, tak jak to miało miejsce na Wyspach Brytyjskich, czy też w związku z tym, że ta epoka przemysłowa przeszła obok nas, bo nas po prostu wtedy nie było na mapie Europy. Więc to wykorzystanie masowe zasobów naturalnych, tak jak mówię, odchodzi do przeszłości. I nowy model kulturowy, przed jakim stoimy, właśnie nie tylko gospodarczy, bo tu gospodarka sama, no to musi być pewien model kulturowy, takiego samoograniczania, umiaru, bo czym jest de facto gospodarka o obiegu zamkniętym, rozszerzona odpowiedzialność producenta, to w prosty sposób moglibyśmy właśnie sprowadzić do słów gospodarka umiaru, gospodarowanie, oszczędność. No powrót do cnót, których tak jadąc tutaj do Państwa parę tysięcy kilometrów, pomyślałam sobie, że to jest taki powrót do takiego ideału średniowiecznego, paradoksalnie człowieka. To średniowiecze mi się przewija już ostatnio w wielu wątkach. Także w gospodarce, która szyje produkty szyte na miarę, gospodarce 4.0, ona także gdzieś tam, jak sobie pomyślę, to sięga wątkami do średniowiecza. No więc powrót, te ideowe korzenie tak naprawdę myślę, że są bardzo istotne. Jeżeli chcemy się na poważnie zmierzyć ze zmianami klimatycznymi, to musimy sobie na poważnie przepowiedzieć, kim jest człowiek i jakie jest jego miejsce w świecie. No ale teraz przekładając już zupełnie na język gospodarki, te wyzwania, przed którymi stoimy, zdefiniowane w polityce europejskiej bardzo mocno, jasno przez przewodniczącą Komisji Europejskiej Ursulę von der Leyen, zamykające się w haśle Nowy Zielony Ład, to stanowi ogromne wyzwanie. Ogromne wyzwanie dla Europy i buduje coś, co nazywamy u nas w ministerstwie takim trylematem, do którego ważne, aby wszyscy decydenci europejscy zdawali sobie sprawę. Ten trylemat to z jednej strony dążenie do tego ideału, do neutralności klimatycznej. Z drugiej strony utrzymanie konkurencyjności, co dzisiaj możemy sobie jasno powiedzieć, że stoi ze sobą w dużej kontrze, w dużej sprzeczności jeszcze, ponieważ technologie, którymi dysponujemy, nie pozwalają nam w sposób konkurencyjny świadczyć pewnych towarów i usług, jeżeli busolą naszą jest neutralność klimatyczna. No i wreszcie handel międzynarodowy na trzecim wierzchołku tego trójkąta, który także powinniśmy, i porządek międzynarodowy, który musimy brać pod uwagę, jeżeli tu w Europie podejmujemy pewne zobowiązania wobec samych siebie. Jest to ogromne wyzwanie z perspektywy Polski. My przygotowując się do zaprezentowania polskiego stanowiska na Radzie Czerwcowej, gdzie ta dyskusja będzie bardzo gorąca w ciągu całego półrocza, na pewno więcej o tym będzie mógł powiedzieć pan premier Jerzy Buzek, przygotowując się minione pół roku spędziliśmy na opracowaniu scenariusza transformacji gospodarki polskiej w stronę zeroemisyjnej. Oczywiście zaznaczenie celu neutralność klimatyczna 2050 jest projekcją marzeń w pewnym sensie, dlatego że nie wiemy, jak rozwiną się pewne technologie w horyzoncie najbliższych 5-7 lat. Nie potrafimy sobie dziś odpowiedzieć na pytanie, mówię my nie tylko tu w Polsce, ale my w Europie, czy będziemy w stanie na przykład opanować technologie wodorowe w stopniu wystarczającym, aby stanowiły one stabilizację systemu energetycznego i wówczas, kiedy słońce nie świeci, a wiatr nie wieje, aby dawały tę podstawę w bazie dla całego przemysłu, dla całej gospodarki. Nie potrafimy odpowiedzieć na to pytanie, a już dziś w Europie pracujemy nad tym, aby te technologie istotnie rozwijać. Zatem nie wiemy, kiedy to nastąpi i nie wiemy, ile będzie kosztowało. Dzisiaj to też nie moja inżynieryjna domena, ale wiemy, że przeprowadzenie procesu, który pozwoli oczyścić i odzyskać wodór, jest bardzo energochłonne. No więc jest to jeden z dylematów. Drugi dylemat, czy akceptujemy w Europie naprawdę atom, czy nie akceptujemy? A zatem czy te nowe technologie atomowe, tak zwane małe reaktory, czy one są konkurencyjne, czy one są wykonalne, czy też nie są. Tej odpowiedzi dzisiaj W horyzoncie najbliższych 5, 7 czy 10 lat my możemy to tylko projektować, ale nie możemy ich bardzo jasno i z dużą pewnością ocenić. Nie muszę mówić, jak to jest, a zatem to jest wyzwanie dla Europy. To nie jest tylko wyzwanie dla Polski. I powiedzmy sobie o tym uczciwie i otwarcie. Kiedy dziś mierzymy się w perspektywą z spadku na globalnym rynku, na zapotrzebowanie na stal i słyszymy o kolejnych informacjach o zamykanych wielkich piecach w Szwecji, w Europie Środkowej, praktycznie Polska jest ostatnim państwem, w którym jeszcze przemysł stalowy realnie i wielkie piece funkcjonują. Słyszymy o problemach największej huty stali w Europie, we Włoszech, we włoskiej Ilwie, czy w zamykanych pół roku temu hutach w Hiszpanii. To jest realne pytanie, na które decydenci europejscy wszyscy muszą sobie odpowiedzieć. Czy wytyczenie takiego celu, co ono oznacza dla produkcji przemysłowej w Europie? Czy chcemy sobie przypadkiem przy okazji powiedzieć, że na pewien przemysł w Europie po prostu nie będzie miejsca? Po prostu dlatego, że nie ma dzisiaj technologii, która pozwoliłaby nam topić stal w inny sposób niż taki, jak robiliśmy to z grubsza rzecz ujmując w XIX wieku. Zatem wiąże się to z taką, a nie inną emisyjnością, z taką, a nie inną emisją CO2. Czy węgiel koksowy będzie wpisany jako raw material krytycznie ważny, a zatem uwzględniony w możliwości eksploatowania w Unii Europejskiej, czy nie? Odpowiedź na to pytanie zmienia kompletnie cykle produkcyjne, jakie będą miały miejsce, bądź jakie nie będą miały miejsca właśnie w Europie najbliższej dekady. Ja nie odpowiadam tutaj dziś na pytanie, co moim zdaniem jest lepsze czy ważniejsze. Ja tylko stawiam te pytania, których brakuje mi w dyskusji na wysokim politycznym europejskim poziomie. Wyznaczenie sobie ambitnych celów jest bardzo istotne i bardzo ważne, ale ważne, z jakimi ono wiąże się konsekwencjami. Jak te konsekwencje wyglądają teraz, schodząc na nasz poziom lokalny Polski? Łatwo sobie wyobrazić i mówimy o tym bardzo często. Polska w 80%, polska gospodarka opierająca się i polski system energetyczny opierający się w 80% na węglu. Przejście dziś nasze do, choć bardzo mocno, jak Państwo wiedzą, zwłaszcza ten ostatni rok, to był rok, ja nie boję się powiedzieć, no rewolucji w systemie energetycznym. I tym tej energetyki dużej, zawodowej i tej energetyki rozproszonej. Ja myślę, że to, o czym możemy z całą pewnością powiedzieć, że proces demokratyzacji produkcji energii w Polsce jest już procesem nieodwracalnym. Mamy ponad 100 tysięcy prosumentów po 2019 roku i ponad 800 megawatów zainstalowanych w słonecznej elektrowni na dachach polskich domów. Łącząc razem z elektrowniami słonecznymi większymi, nieprosumenckimi, to jest ponad 1 gigawat mocy, który wytwarzany jest z energii ze słońca. Tego trendu już się w Polsce nie powstrzyma i o tym jestem przekonana, że ten technologiczny przełom, ale także cenowy, który sprawiło zniesienie ceł w Unii Europejskiej na panele fotowoltaiczne w połowie 2018 roku, po prostu tego trendu nie zatrzymamy. Co więcej, jeśli posłuchamy o największych akwizycjach, jakie ogłosiły i Tauron, i PGE w drugiej połowie ubiegłego roku, farmy wiatrowe w przypadku Tauronu na lądzie, w przypadku PGE inwestycji offshore'owej, to widzimy, jak ten system, tak jak mówię, produkcji energii zawodowej także się zmienia i że będzie to z całą pewnością znak rozpoznawczy najbliższych i inwestycyjny w ciągu najbliższych lat. Dlaczego to robimy? To rzecz jasna. 2018 rok, zmierzch 2018 roku upłynął nam wszystkim pod wysokim napięciem gwałtownego wzrostu cen energii elektrycznej związanej z 300% wzrostem cen emisji do uprawnień CO2. Naszym celem, i mówię to z perspektywy mojego ministerstwa, jest to, aby dostarczać polskiemu małemu, średniemu biznesowi, dużym inwestorom, dużym inwestycjom, no i wreszcie Kowalskim i Nowakom prądu taniego i czystego. I taki jest nasz cel, aby długoterminowo ktoś, kto planuje inwestycje w Polsce, miał przewidywalną cenę energii, bo w przeciwnym razie utracimy tę przewagę konkurencyjną, którą mamy dzisiaj, którą konsekwentnie utrzymujemy od 2015 roku, czyli wzrost rok do roku bezpośrednich inwestycji zagranicznych. Dzisiaj ci inwestorzy, kiedy do nas przychodzą, pytają nas już nie tylko o grunt, nie tylko o uzbrojenie działki, nie tylko o ulgi podatkowe, ale coraz częściej zadają nam pytanie, czy będą mogli na produktach, które wyjdą z ich fabryk, naklejać zielone naklejki. To oznacza, czy ten produkt jest wytworzony zgodnie z systemem certyfikacji Unii Europejskiej, a zatem, że energia do jego wytworzenia pochodzi z odnawialnych źródeł energii. I to jest też ten element, z którego sobie zdajemy sprawę i który chcemy móc dostarczać i chcemy móc zapewniać inwestorom. Sytuacja, w której się znajdujemy, jak powiedzieliśmy na początku, to sytuacja wielkiej zmiany. W tej sytuacji, jak wiemy, wielu ekonomistów zwraca uwagę na takie trzy modele postaw. Jeden to mówimy o sytuacji kruchej, czyli takiej, w której, czy takich warunkach, które w wyniku gwałtownej zmiany czy kryzysu powodują rozpad, powodują upadek. Druga, stabilna, to taka, których te sytuacje są w stanie sytuację kryzysową przetrwać. No i wreszcie trzecia to antykrucha, czyli taka, która z danego kryzysu może uczynić swoją dźwignię rozwojową. Moim marzeniem, ale także głębokim przekonaniem jest to, że ta technologiczna zmiana i ta polityczna zmiana, w jakiej jesteśmy dzisiaj, jest szansą rozwojową dla Polski. My mówimy od kilku lat o tych elementach rozwojowych, na których opierała się polska gospodarka od 1989 roku, które o tych zasobach, które powoli się wyczerpały. Mówiliśmy o zasobach takich jak tania siła robocza, jako przede wszystkim nasz podstawowy lewar rozwojowy, no i wreszcie konsumpcja, która także powoli będzie się wychładzać. Widzimy to, te dane z ostatnich miesięcy minionego roku wskazują na to, że Polacy chętniej zaczynają oszczędzać niż tylko konsumować. Zatem te elementy wzrostu powoli zaczynają odchodzić do historii. A zatem z tej kruchości jesteśmy w stanie wykrzesać antykruche rozwiązania. I podam Państwu jeden przykład, który paradoksalnie pokazuje, jak właśnie niedorozwój w kilku gospodarczy, ekonomiczny, technologiczny w kilku obszarach może w wypadku gwałtownej zmiany być dla nas dobrym prognostykiem. Pierwszy z nich to jest sektor bankowy, wielokrotnie pokazywany. Jak często pokazujemy, sektor bankowy w Polsce jeden z najlepiej rozwiniętych w Europie. Technologicznie z całą pewnością banki polskie i banki w Polsce i oddziały zachodnioeuropejskich banków w Polsce oferują najlepsze towary i usługi technologiczne, dlatego że Polacy do nich się szybko dostosowują i są gotowi z nich korzystać. Odsetek osób starszych korzystających z bankowości elektronicznej w Polsce jest ponad średnią europejską. Zawsze żartuję, że przez to, że Polacy nie mieli zbyt wiele oszczędności w PRL-u i nie mieli książeczek czekowych, nie musieli ich najpierw tych książeczek czekowych wycofywać po to, aby wprowadzać karty płatnicze, a następnie płatności bezgotówkowe, więc ten jeden etap rozwojowy, czy też ten etap niedorozwoju mogliśmy szybciej przeskoczyć. I teraz inna historia, bardziej związana z systemem energetycznym, z transformacją w stronę nowego zielonego ładu. Bardzo wielkie kontrowersje wzbudziła skorygowana w poprzedniej kadencji ustawa odległościowa wiatrowa, te tak zwane 10H, które wprowadziliśmy, które rzeczywiście wyhamowało inwestycje w elektrownie wiatrowe na lądzie. Ale co się wydarzyło? To polecam Państwa uwadze, bardzo dużą dyskusję w Niemczech na przełomie listopada i grudnia w kilku landach, które są najmocniej pokryte wiatrakami, tej pierwszej generacji powiedzielibyśmy, gdzie narasta opór społeczny, gdzie narasta zniechęcenie, gdzie obywatele mówią, że nie chcą mieć masztów pod oknami, ich wysokie niezadowolenie. Oczywiście dzisiaj ten problem technologicznie się zmienia w taki sposób, że nowe maszty, nowe farmy wiatrowe są sadzane na znacznie wyższych masztach, a zatem trzeba ich zatem znacznie mniej, aby wytworzyć adekwatną wartość energetyczną, jak farmy wiatrowe stawiane 10-15 lat temu. I znowu my dziś, kiedy mówimy o korekcie tej ustawy, którą chcemy przeprowadzić, korzystając z najlepszych europejskich praktyk, uwzględniając w procesie decyzyjnym głos wspólnoty lokalnej, Zapewne uruchomimy po raz kolejny, bo to także słyszymy z regionów, w kilku regionach, które bardzo potrzebują i bardzo na to czekają, gdzie samorządy, wspólnoty lokalne są na to gotowe, uruchomimy inwestycje już kolejnej generacji, już nie tych właśnie lasów wiatrowych, ale znacznie bardziej przyjaznych dla otoczenia technologii. Więc i w tym przypadku ja widzę raczej tę antykruchość w znacznym obszarze inwestycyjnym w Polsce. To, co jest naszym ogromnym wyzwaniem, to, co wiąże się ze zmianą, to także zmiany na rynku pracy. Już dzisiaj mówimy o tym, że w ciągu najbliższych 5 lat około 30% zawodów znanych nam historycznie najprawdopodobniej zniknie. Ale jak mają się dane, tak powszechnie przecież publikowane i dystrybuowane, i robimy to i w Polsce, one są dane powszechnie dostępne, z badaniami, które także są prowadzone na kolejnych pokoleniach młodych Polaków. W 2019 roku bardzo ciekawe badania tak zwanych pokoleń, oczywiście socjologicznie nazywanych pokoleniem X i pokoleniem Z, czyli pokolenie tych lat 80 do 94, i tych urodzonych po 1994 roku, to co piąty przedstawiciel i jednego, i drugiego pokolenia jest przekonany, że będzie wykonywał swój zawód w jednym miejscu do końca życia. Zatem widzimy kompletnie nieadekwatność oczekiwań i aspiracji tych młodych ludzi, którzy na rynek pracy dopiero wchodzą albo właśnie weszli, z tymi, jak zmienią się warunki życia, warunki ich pracy. To jest ogromna zmiana i to jest zmiana, z którą także przychodzi się nam mierzyć, co do której my powinniśmy dostrajać odpowiednie instrumenty polityk publicznych, ale na które rynek i pracownicy powinni, i pracodawcy powinni także być gotowi i powinni być świadomi. Podsumowując zatem, Nowy Zielony Ład zdefiniuje w bardzo poważnym stopniu i na bardzo poważnym poziomie zmianę technologiczną, zmianę organizacyjną, zmianę produkcyjną. To, co jest naszym wyzwaniem, to sprawić, aby ta dyskusja nie była jedynie i tylko dyskusją zamkniętą wewnątrz granic europejskich, bo my dzisiaj konkurujemy nie wewnątrz Unii Europejskiej, pomiędzy krajami, ale konkurujemy globalnie. Jeśli będzie tak, że nasze cele polityczne doprowadzą do tak zwanego carbon leakage, czyli do wycofywania się sektorów, gałęzi gospodarczych z Europy do państw nieobciążonych tego typu celami politycznymi, celami podatkowymi, wówczas na tym trójkącie zarysowanym przeze mnie przed chwilą stracimy na pewno na konkurencyjności. Naszym zadaniem powinno być zatem promowanie idei Zielonego Ładu w taki sposób, aby ona stała się elementem światowego porządku handlowego. W przeciwnym razie grozi nam perspektywa skansenu, którą zarysował na początku pan redaktor. Drugie ważne wyzwanie, które z tego tytułu płynie, to jest rzeczywiście i bezsprzecznie konieczność już zaprzestania odmieniania innowacyjności przez przypadki, i mówię to w Europie, bo to jest wyzwanie nasze europejskie, a przejście do bardziej radykalnych działań, radykalnych w zakresie obsługi, a nie celów, bo jak często powtarzam, gdyby Elon Musk miał na swoją X-Space aplikować do horyzontu Europa przyszłego, może przyszłego się zmieni, do horyzontu 2020, z całą pewnością nie byłby dzisiaj ze swoimi produktami w tym miejscu, w którym jest, albo być może w ogóle by się zniechęcił drugiego dnia. Więc musimy zmienić podejście w Komisji Europejskiej i w Europie do zasad dystrybucji środków na przełomowe technologie. No i trzeci niezwykle istotny obszar, w którym wiemy i po cichu i głośno o nim mówimy, tej części gospodarki, która odpłynęła nam, Europejczykom, w ciągu ostatnich 10 lat, czyli mówię tutaj o gospodarce platformowej. Ta gospodarka dzisiaj raczej korzysta z jednolitego europejskiego rynku, niż rynek europejski jest jej beneficjentem. Bardzo mocno, głośno dyskutujemy na temat podatku od usług cyfrowych, na temat podatków od platform. To wywołuje ogromne konwulsje polityczne, tak naprawdę we wszystkich państwach europejskich. Natomiast zamiast tego typu dyskusji podatkowych, ja sugerowałabym próbę odpowiedzi na pytanie, czy Europa jest w stanie tutaj konkurować, czy ten czas przypadkiem nam nie minął, czy zamiast mówić o strategiach opracowywania sztucznej inteligencji, nie powinniśmy realnie wykonać realnych kroków w tej sprawie. Już nie strategie pułkowniki, ale realna próba odpowiedzi. Czasami odważnych, bo tutaj w przypadku strategii sztucznej inteligencji musimy sobie odpowiedzieć, co dla nas Europejczyków jest ważniejsze. Czy ochrona danych osobowych, czy realne rozwiązania technologiczne, które przed nami stoją. Jeśli będziemy stać doktrynalnie, bardzo mocno, pryncypialnie na straży danych osobowych, ograniczymy swobodę ich przepływu, to myślę, że powinniśmy sobie równocześnie odpowiedzieć na pytanie, czy też stwierdzić, że rozwiązania z zakresu sztucznej inteligencji będą nam przynosić, co już zresztą robią, rozwiązania koncernów pozaeuropejskich. To podstawowe dylematy, które dzisiaj przed nami stoją i to są podstawowe tezy i pytania, z którymi my jako Polska idziemy w tę trudną debatę w ciągu najbliższego pół roku i pół roku, bo do czerwcowej rady, ale także całego roku, jeśli mówimy o wspólnym europejskim budżecie, wieloletnim planie finansowym, które będziemy stali, te pytania, które będziemy się starali stawiać. Ja będę gospodarzem przed spotkaniem rady czerwcowej grupy państw przyjaciół przemysłu, tych kilkunastu państw, które są bardzo mocno zorientowane przemysłowo i które podobne dylematy i podobne pytania stawiają, choć nie mówią o nich na pierwszych stronach ważnych, wpływowych europejskich czasopism. Te pytania postaramy się postawić w taki sposób, aby odpowiedzi, które Rada będzie chciała przyjąć w czerwcu, brały pod uwagę, wiedząc o tym, że jest dla nas wartością, jest dla nas zadaniem utrzymanie tego, iż Europa będzie ustanawiać trendy, tak jak to robiła od tej wspomnianej przeze mnie jeszcze średniowiecznego czasu po wiek XX. Bo to, co wydarzy się w wieku XXI, jest obarczone bardzo dużą niepewnością. Dziękuję bardzo.
Dzień dobry. Good morning. My name is Joanna Becker and I'm the Deputy Managing Director of Polityka Insight. Today I will have the pleasure of co-chairing the debate together with Andrzej on how climate changes everything. But first, let me introduce our guests, our speakers. First, I would like to ask to the stage Beth Gardner, a freelance environmental journalist. Her latest book, Choked, has been named one of the Guardian's best books of 2019. Welcome, Beth.
Hi.
Good to see you.
Andrzej, hi.
Please take a seat.
I would like to invite Karolina Garcia Gomez, the CEO of IKEA Retail Poland. Welcome, Karolina.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. Prime Minister Jerzy Buzek, member of the European Parliament. Welcome.
Zapraszamy. Well, I will shake your hand.
Yes.
Madam.
Hello.
And Mikołaj Dowgielewicz, permanent representative of the European Investment Bank Group to the EU institutions in Brussels. Welcome. Some people call the climate crisis a civilizational wake-up call. They say that it will change our societies, our lifestyles, our economy, our politics. It will change everything, no matter whether we want it or not. According to the latest Eurobarometer, 93% of Europeans think that the climate crisis is very serious, and that 79% say that it is more than very serious. So my first question goes to Beth. You called the climate crisis in your book an invisible catastrophe. You said that we've faced years of denial. And now, how do societies react to this growing awareness of the climate crisis?
Well, I mean, I do think you're right that the public awareness and concern about this has really been rising to a new level over the last few years. I think particularly since the release, I think it's 2 years ago now, of the IPCC scientific report saying, you know, what got sort of widely reported as 12 years left to save the world or to stop climate change, with Greta Thunberg and the spread of these Fridays for Future, the school strikes, Extinction Rebellion in the UK and elsewhere. We've really seen this issue kind of starting to explode onto the agenda in a way that has not happened before. I think it's still really important to say that action is not matching that at all. You know, there's really no country at this point in the world that's doing what the science tells us that we need to be doing in order to actually keep temperature rises to a stable level. And I do also think that there's a potential for this issue to really be a fracturing sort of issue. I mean, I think in the last few decades, we've sort of developed this notion of environmental issues as sort of these kinds of problems that we come together to solve them. You know, it's a sort of unifying thing. But I think there's a danger now that this is starting to become a splintering issue. And I think that we really saw that particularly in the European elections last spring, when you had really strong performances both among the Green parties and other parties embracing climate in a proactive way, and among the far right, sort of more nationalistic parties, some of whom are starting to, I think there's two approaches that we're seeing now on the right, because I think that there's a starting to be an understanding on the political right that this is not something you can really ignore anymore. It's becoming, like you said, it's something that the public is very concerned about. So I think we've started to see some parties really kind of try to weaponize a climate denialism and weaponize climate as an issue that sort of, as a culture war issue, in a way that we've been more familiar with perhaps in the United States for a long time, that this is, you know, environmentalists becoming hysterical, it's the left going crazy, and it's a preoccupation of sort of elites, and that they're using it to kind of as another tool to push down the sort of ordinary people. And I think, you know, we've seen that with, for example, the AfD in Germany, the Finns party in Finland, as immigration has cooled down a little bit as an issue for them, the climate has become a new hot button. And I think we're also starting to see other parties on the right that are using this to, you know, to divide as a sort of nationalistic issue and to turn countries against one another. So I think that's something to really be aware of going forward. And I also think that in the discussion around climate change, you know, in the sort of the groupings and the media and the people who are interested and concerned about trying to deal with it, I do think that there's been a real failure in the focus of the public conversation around this. And I think it's easy to see where it comes from, but I think what we've ended up with is a real fixation in the way that we talk about this issue on the areas of kind of personal responsibility and individual choice. So you see sort of never-ending coverage and discussion of, you know, should I go vegan? Which, you know, kind of car should I buy? Or which, you know, this or that should I buy? And those things are important, and obviously personal decisions matter, and we have power as consumers. But I think it really obscures the much, much bigger questions around the sustainability of the systems that sort of underpin our world and the political failures, and in particular, the corporate abuses that have led us to this point of crisis that we're at right now.
So we will talk politics in a moment, but I would like to stay with society and our lifestyles and exactly what you said.
Yeah.
But if we have 12 years, as you say, scientists say, we have 12 years, will people be willing to sacrifice, really collectively sacrifice, change their lifestyles, change the way they drive? Or does it really matter? Because I understand that you say that it's really a bigger picture, still we have people that are willing to sometimes sacrifice, but then on the other hand, those that say, I'm very concerned about climate, but they don't change anything. So do you think that it matters at all? Or
sure, I mean, everything matters, right? But whether you personally, you know, change the light bulbs in your house, or, you know, whether you take a certain flight. Yes, those things matter, but there's not enough people, I don't think, across our societies that are voluntarily making these changes. That is not going to get us where we need to go. You know, you and I, as individuals, we don't have the power to, you know, change the energy makeup of Poland or of the UK where I live or of the US and to push systems away from coal and gas and towards wind and solar. You know, of course, we get home at the end of the day and we want to turn on the light and we want to charge our phones and our laptops and all of that, right? We live in a modern world. It's only our governments that have the ability to make those kinds of changes. You know, if you're talking about flying, who is it that has the power to put the kind of regulation that will push our systems towards a lower carbon foundation? It's not individuals making these choices. What we need is a bigger systems. And I think what we've seen over the past decades is, you know, I think there's a useful framework in some of the reporting that's been done on this around this notion of accountability and how have we gotten to where we are right now. The Guardian published a big series last year called The Polluters, and they worked with some data analysts and came up with some statistics indicating that the top 100 most polluting companies in the world are responsible for, I think it's 40% or something like that, I can't remember the figure, of carbon pollution over the past decades. These are companies like ExxonMobil, like Shell, like Saudi Aramco, the huge oil and gas producers that have been, you know, not only unwilling to move towards research on cleaner energy and away from fossil fuels, but have been spending tremendous amounts of money to propagate doubt about the science and have gotten us locked, particularly in the United States where I'm from, but elsewhere too, into this never-ending debate about, you know, is it real? Is it happening? Is it man-made? Is it serious? That just leads around in circles. And what they've also tried to do, I think, is to lock us also into these finger-pointing arguments about, you know, you took a flight, you ate a hamburger, that doesn't lead us forward, right? Meanwhile, Exxon is and Shell and the others are continuing to, you know, invest billions of dollars in new infrastructure to extract more fossil fuels that we know.
Okay,
if
but
we burn
Beth,
them, we're in big
don't
trouble.
You, don't
yeah.
you think that it all needs to start with individuals? I mean, businesses will not change if their consumers won't make them change, governments won't change if voters won't make them change. I mean, don't you think that it's not about finger pointing, it's about who gives the impulse, and the impulse has to come from consumers, from individuals, from voters. And isn't this a situation where society needs to own up and to say, okay, this is serious and we're gonna take it seriously?
Sure, and I don't mean to suggest that individual choices don't matter. Of course they do, and of course as an individual you can, you know, decide where you want to spend your money and understand that that has an impact. But I just think that the scale of that is not enough, and while there's nothing wrong with it and it's important, I think that because it's very tangible and because we all, you know, live in a world where we're making those kinds of consumer choices all the time, it's very easy to wrap your head around, okay, if I buy this instead of that, or if I don't buy an airline ticket or what have you, that's something tangible. Whereas these bigger systems that sort of underpin our world, you know, government power, government regulatory decisions that determine, you know, where your energy is coming when you switch on the light, those things are a little bit invisible to us, even though they are much larger, you know, and your carbon footprint is going to be much more determined if you live in Poland by where the power is coming from, whether it's coal burning or solar or wind, than, you know, what you buy when you go to the supermarket. So I think we tend to focus on what's visible to us, and these less visible things are actually very significant, and we're losing sight of that.
Okay.
Karina, do you agree that the impulse should come from consumers, or do you think that also is the corporate side's responsibility to influence the lifestyles of consumers?
Mm-hmm.
Yes, I think the situation is so crucial at the moment that it's not either or anymore, but it's much more both and. And we need to do whatever, you know, we need to do both at the same time. So that's why I think on one hand, big companies like IKEA need to take some commitments on how they operate. And as you say, we have a lot of responsibility. And that's why we have been doing really big commitments on have a positive impact and a climate positive and circularity by 2030. And this is the big actions that with the speed we need to take. And on the other hand, we also know and we are asking consumers and we have seen in different researches that the worry and the awareness of what climate change is increasing very rapidly. In 2017, we had like 65% of Poles in Poland. They think that they were worried about climate change. 2019 was already 88% of the people that are really worried. The thing is that what they say is that mainly of them, they would really like to change their behaviors. 90% they would really like to take some actions, but some of them, they don't know why or how they can do that. So that's why we decided in IKEA, okay, let's go for both parts. One is our operations, our commitments, and how to change the business model into more sustainable model. But on the other hand, we also have a big influence. If we take globally in the world, we can we say that we influence 1 billion people. And we really want to make a better everyday life for these million people within the limits of the planet. In Poland, we have 5 million households where we have our products somehow in the homes. We know that from our range, we have more than 4,000 products that have some sustainability in their way of being made with renewable or recyclable material, but all how they are designed in order to support customers to have a more sustainable life. So we really think that we need to enable and inspire many more people just to have these products with the solutions, but also a big responsibility to make this affordable, because we know that, of course, this sustainability cannot be something premium, but it has to be something for the many. And that's the balance that we need to have, how to make these products as affordable as possible. And if we see a little bit the reaction of the consumers, we see that during the last year, we have sold more than 11 million of these products, only in LED bulbs. It's 1.5 billion LED bulbs sold in Poland, you know? And of course, if you start to think, if a million or billion people in the planet change their LED bulbs, if a billion people not use single plastic anymore, of course, small steps will have a big impact. But as you say, I agree with both. We have to go in that direction. But on the other hand, every company needs to have the big responsibility to change the business model into that.
Okay, Karolina, I wanted to ask you, not necessarily as the CEO of IKEA, but rather as a representative of business. Mm. I'd like to ask you about the elephant in the room, which is greenwashing, which I think Beth sort of touched upon. And my question would be, don't you think that if business doesn't change the way it thinks, if there's not going to be a paradigm shift in the thinking about how to make a profit and at what cost to make a profit, then we won't get anywhere anyway, even if, you know, we're going to do this little bit and that little bit, and then we're not going to use straws and we're going to... But don't you think that there needs to be a huge sort of recalculation of how this whole system works, and it needs, and businesses need to own up to it?
Of course, it's a transformation also in the business model as such. But we think, we are very positive. We think that it will be a win-win situation. And all these changes that we are doing is bringing us even more business. And I can be very specific examples. The veggie bowls, you know, in IKEA that are replacing the meatballs. You know, they are more healthy, they are more sustainable, less CO2 emission. And at the same time, it's giving us more business, if I have to be honest, you know. So then I think it's how to think in that way. How can we convert and how the sustainability business will be the new business concept in the future, and it will bring much more profit to the companies at the end. So it's.
But isn't it with being on a diet that you just need to eat less? I mean, there are things that are sort of, you know, negative calories like celery sticks. But I mean, who believes that? Don't you think that if you wanna be on a diet, then you just basically have to eat less and not more?
I mean, it's like energy, no? You say, do we need, like we are in our operations in the store, we say, okay, we have to use renewable energy, but also we have to be more efficient on the use of our energy. So, of course, it's the balance of both, no? How are we really trying to have a conscience that we need to reduce or be much more efficient on the way we are doing, but at the same time using renewable energy in order to make it happen. So yes, it's of course a balance.
Panie premierze, Professor Buzek, before we move on to energy transformation and about how to finance the change that needs to happen anyway, I wanted to touch upon politics, something that Beth started talking about. Are we actually still living a cultural war? Is it still the left that and the Greens that are fighting for climate? Because we heard Jadwiga Emilewicz, who says that she comes from a right-wing, quite obviously from a quite right-wing government, and that climate issues are important for her. Aren't we at a moment where climate change doesn't have sort of political colors, but basically it's at the center of debate?
Well, it's not a new issue at all, let me say, because we should remind ourselves that 20 years ago in the German government, we had the most responsible people, Gerhard Schröder and Joschka Fischer. And Joschka Fischer is a purely green representative. So nothing special. It was the same in 30, 40 years ago in Europe. And we started, generally speaking, the environmental protection in Europe and in the United States 60 years ago, 50 years ago. Before that, we had acid rains. You don't remember probably what that. Acid rains around Puławy in Poland or any coal power station. No trees at all. For example, in Izerskie Mountains, close to coal power station. And now it's a quite new era of our answer to the environmental problems. The same in Poland. 30 years ago, our rivers were the most polluted rivers probably in Europe, or maybe even wider. Well, everything is clean today. It was not Green's decision. It was our decision, either socialists or liberals, a representative of EPP party in Europe, and it is always the same. Of course, we listen to the Greens all the time. It is permanent discussion. Several years ago, I was responsible for the biggest program for research and development, it is now Horizon 2020. The next one will be Horizon Europe. 50, 60, 100 billion euro. And Green's proposal was to go towards, it was 12, 13 years ago, towards new energy era. And we spent more than half of our money within all the industrial problems on the advice of Greens to develop all the technologies in renewables. And now we see the result. Green farms, offshore wind farms are the cheapest ones from the point of view of energy generation. So it's nothing new. I think in the time of crisis, for example, 10 years ago, well, Greens were very, very weak in Europe. 20 years ago, very strong. 10 years ago, because of crisis, very weak. And now back, fortunately, thanks to our economy, growing economy, they are still, once again, very strong.
But you keep talking about the Greens as a party. And what I'd venture an opinion that basically we could be seeing the end of the Greens Party, because what the Greens Party stood for in the different countries is now part of, intrinsically, of all the elements of the political debate. If you look at, it's this government, the peace government, that started the Ministry of Climate. If you look at, the Conservatives in Great Britain, they were one of the the old conservatives, not the ones that are in charge now. They had sort of, you know, climate change on the lapels. I mean, isn't this a wider phenomenon that climate change and everything green is becoming central for political discourse, and not only, you know, for the Greens in the given country or the given, you know, European Parliament?
It is very, very important from point of view of politics in Europe and all over the world. I think have been very important since the 1990s, last century. But we maybe didn't pay so much attention to that. Of course, the reason was the public opinion. They didn't understand. They haven't understood till now. And now it's quite different situation, absolutely difficult, because we see the result. And I'm quite sure that climate issue becomes the most important driver of European and Polish politics. And of course, European Green Deal is dedicated not only to the climate issue straightforward. What is very important? Well, circular economy, no plastics, many other things. But, well, maybe climate neutrality 2050 is the most important slogan, and quite clear slogan for all of us. And I'm quite sure it will be our driver for next 20, 30 years. After 20, 30 years, it will be quite normal, because we will go forward for next decades without a big changes from this point of view, from that point of view. In general, we should change everything in our economy, but it's not as difficult, I hope. I'm rather optimistic. As difficult as we think sometimes, if we start to do it step by step, and we will have a strategic program also for our country. We do not have any strategic program for our country from point of view of energy transition, for example. Incredible. We need such a program for 20, 30 years to know how to, for example, go out from the coal, because it's absolutely necessary. Why? Because we produce in our country, in Upper Silesia especially, I'm from Upper Silesia, so I can say it, we produce very poor coal, poor quality coal, and very costly. So we buy our coal in Russia. So we would like to prevent, we don't like to buy gas, natural gas from Russia, to be dependent on Russia. So is it a new way of independence of our energy sector, buying coal from Russia? Well, it's almost stupid. So to go out in, well, except of Lublin, coal mine, because it's Bogdanka is quite good, and for next decades could be even supportive. But all the others, it's quite natural way, it's nothing special, but it's necessary to discuss with the workers. We should take care of them, because they are jobs for them. And while the whole history, as a matter of fact, very important in Upper Silesia. I know something about that. When I was responsible for Polish government, together with my colleagues from the government, we took decision to close 22, 23 coal mines in 1 year. And, well, let me say trade unions said, okay, is no other possibility. But after many, many months, or maybe 1 or 2 years of heavy discussion, if we are open to our citizens and we can show them the results, if we don't go in certain way, we can manage a lot. So discussing issue of future, European Green Deal, and everything what is around of Green Deal, because it's also transport, it's not only energy. Well, transport depends on energy as well. Gasoline electric cars is everything, energy sector, but also agriculture, buildings, everything is inside of European Green Deal. So let us think about that seriously. Let us go to very important issue of innovation. I agree with you that to say innovation, well, I cannot listen to this word as well, because we try to repeat it, well, since the beginning of this century, probably, but still is no other way, just to go to innovation policy, and we can manage, I am quite sure. But Polish government should be part, and Poland should be part of the European, big European Green Deal and European Union climate neutrality by 2050. Otherwise, we should not expect a big support from the European Union. It's quite obvious.
Yeah, that's exactly
I hear that there's something like that in the European Parliament.
That's exactly the question. This is the question raised about the European Green Deal, a very ambitious project, as we say. But first of all, is it enough for climate, and is it not too much for Poland? And then will the other countries, there's the justice argument that is very often played in Brussels, meaning will the capitals want to support pro-Poland? Because there are others that have, as you said, you have agricultural issues in different countries, and then in Poland we raise our questions. So how do you think that this will evolve?
Well, I wouldn't like to be too enthusiastic about the whole issue, because it will be not easy for all of us, not only in Poland, especially in Poland, maybe in Upper Silesia or in Konin region or some others. It will be very difficult, I would like to say, easy goal. But if we think about clean air, for example, and what is really dangerous for all of us each day, from the point of view, for example, our health, cancer, and other problems. It is absolutely necessary, and people also in my region, in Upper Silesia, Zagłębie, Śląsk Voivodeship, they understand the very serious reason for going this direction. It will be very, very difficult, very, very costly, and we should prepare ourselves, investment, innovation, new funds, cohesion policy to take care of our citizens from such regions. Because we should give a very strong signal to our citizens from some coal regions especially. Why? Because they will lose their jobs. And we wouldn't like to make them, opposition towards the European Union decision, because it's European Union decision. Green Deal is European decision. If we go too far and too fast, we will lose at the end, because our citizens will say, no, we wouldn't like to go so fast. We need jobs, we need so on, so on. It's not necessary to explain it to us. So, not everything what Greens are saying is possible to fulfill. We should be slightly more moderate.
Okay. Mikołaj, do you think we can innovate and invest our way out of this mess?
Well, first of all, I think this discussion is always about whether the glass is half empty or half full. I always prefer to be on the latter side, so glass is half full. I would say my basic statement is you can have all the money in the world to mobilize, to fight, to do climate action and also environmental sustainability. And I mention environmental sustainability because if you talk about politics, I think stories about dying bees and about our fish eating plastic are more appealing to people sometimes even than stories about big meteorological events. And I think this is also a very important part. So, yes, I think we can find a way out of this. First of all, you have to mobilize public actors. There's obviously a question of what will be the regulatory solutions. Here, Brussels or the European Union is leading the way. What I would mention specifically is the draft agreement now on the so-called taxonomy, which Prime Minister Buzek knows very well. It's from the European Parliament. It's a question of how you actually regulate investments or how you actually regulate financial world in an effort to mobilize sustainable investments. So although not all the details are entirely clear yet, but that will clearly steer the money flow towards sustainable investments. And if you still believe that Brussels is regulatory capital of the world, as The Economist wrote, I think, about 15 years ago, now you can question, you know, with Brexit, Donald Trump and all that, and rising China, whether this is still the case. So if it's still the case, then taxonomy will have a huge impact on global markets. And if you see what has been the decision of the BlackRock, the largest asset manager in the world recently in mid-January, when they said, I think, 25% of their assets will be shifting to sustainable investments, it's a huge decision. They are much bigger than any government can be in this world. And I would say, so there's a regulatory issue. I would not go too much into detail because that's obviously fascinating, but it's we don't have a place for that. Then there is public actors. So the actor number one, of course, in Europe and beyond is the institution I represent, the European Union investment arm, EIB. EIB Group, actually, because we also have European Investment Fund, which is important for innovation, not also in climate action. Here we have said that we would mobilize 1 trillion of investments between 21 and 30, so in this new decade. That is also a very important signal, notably for public and multilateral banks, and there are many of them, because that is also somehow setting the trend. And then there is, of course, when you talk about public actors, Prime Minister Buzek was talking about just transition. Indeed, there is a big role for the EU now to mobilize resources for the just transition mechanism, including loans and including grants. And I believe here that's probably also politically the only way out of the quagmire, how to find a deal on the multilateral financial framework. If you combine the two, climate neutrality and the MFF, that's the way for the cohesion countries to say we are not losing that much in the end because we gain more public resources for climate action. So that's the public side. Now, then you have the real markets. First of all, you have the treasury papers, you have the stock exchanges, and you have basically a booming market for green bonds. I mean, the EIB group has been the pioneer in this, because since 2007, when we started, we have sold over 28 billion of green bonds. We have now also started doing, since 2018, what we call sustainability awareness bonds. So, for example, for projects linked with water, the next one of sustainable goals will be education, and then we'll go into other areas as well. And that is proving to be successful. This market is growing, and as you know, Poland also issues already for a number of years green bonds, and they are sold. They are sold easily. And then, of course, when we talk about the private actors, there must be a match between the public and the private, because obviously the only way public actors can act is as catalysts, and that is the role for such multilateral banks as the EIB in Europe, but of course globally for others as well, like the World Bank, for example. So to crowd in private sector. And that's why I say you can have all the money in the world for this type of investments if you only want to. Because if you have those elements falling into place, politics, public actors, changing habits, but also a real economic and industrial revolution. And I think this is already taking place, and this is the most difficult part of this chain. Because well, we are, of course, in Poland talking about coal mines, and indeed the government of Jerzy Buzek was the one that undertaken the most impressive reform of that sector, but also the regional transformation of the green transformation, so to say, in that region. But there are also other examples. There is the Ruhr region in Germany, which has been transformed enormously. There is also other examples in Europe. So this has already happened, but on a smaller scale. Now what we will be witnessing is probably much bigger industrial revolution, because whole sectors of economy, it's not just a question of whether they will stay in Europe or not. But that is also, by the way, a question for regulators, because we'll see discussions on the carbon tax pretty soon coming from the European Commission and so on. On energy taxation, there are also proposals in the pipeline. But there is simply a question of which industries will survive and which will have to completely change. You mentioned Exxon. Of course, those guys, they will go on what they are doing, but they also have to be mindful of the coming change. So, for example, what about the green shipping? We have been already trying to invest in green shipping, because why, at least the oil tankers, they could be more green. They could run on electricity, perhaps on batteries rather than on oil. So there is a lot of questions which need to be addressed. And my final point is that I think we are too apocalyptic always in Poland. We try to speak about the looming disaster, looming catastrophe, and I think that's really not the way to address it, because beyond the real issues that need to be addressed in the context of few regions, I would say green transition is an opportunity that we can seize. It's an opportunity like the one we had back in 1989 to completely change the country. There is a lot that you can do. There's a lot of innovation that you can really step up your place on the ladder when it comes to the competitiveness. It's really an opportunity for consumers. It's also an opportunity for businesses, but you have to address it in a positive way. I mean, it's there's no point just to you know, to whinge about the same issues all over again. We lost too many years already in Poland, if I can say we. I represent the European Investment Bank in Poland, but I will not go too further into this, but I've been hearing the same arguments here for the last 15 years. Thank you.
Prime Minister, you wanted to add?
Well, only one short question, if I may, Mr. Director General. Well, is a possibility of EIB investment in natural gas sector, because for transition period would be very important for such a country like Poland, and even thinking that in the future it will be renewable gas, will be also hydrogen and so on. It will be not only natural gas in the future. Possibility of investment would be very important for some member states.
Well, there is, we have accepted, or we have adopted the new energy lending policy of the bank in November. And we are not going to finance any more unabated fossil fuel projects. So we are not going to invest in gas pipelines if they only serve to service the existing traffic. We will continue investing in those projects which would bring down the carbon emission. So, for example, when it is a question of a possibility of modernizing a pipe to bring to transport hydrogen, to bring biogas, to transport sort of low carbon gases. But for every specific project, you would have to look at the life cycle of a project to see exactly how this would fit into our technical criteria to be able, whether we would be able to finance it, because those criteria are quite strict. But, Prime Minister, we have just approved two big wind farm projects in Poland, in Pomerania and in Wielkopolska. And I believe and I hope we will have more of those projects, including with those state companies which are known in Poland for gas pipelines, because they seem to be interested in diversification as well.
Okay, I wanted to open up the debate. And what I wanted to do just quickly is to have a small vote. And I wrote out sort of four scenarios, and I'm gonna say them out loud real fast. One is we're doomed. Two is we can figure this out in a business as usual scenario. Three is we need a revolution in thinking and doing. And four is we're overreacting. What do you guys think? Again, we're doomed, we can figure this out, we need a revolution, or, you know, we're overreacting.
I think we need a revolution in the way we do things. I think to just say we're doomed is useless, but we need
unless
to,
we are.
Yeah, we're doomed if we don't act.
Okay, what do you think? You're obviously the business as usual, glass half full. We can figure.
No,
out.
It's not business as usual. It's a well, huge revolution, but it's and we are going to. Everybody will feel the change, but we have to take on the challenge. I mean, you cannot just. I mean, otherwise you just you know.
Okay. Yeah. No. But my point is that you're talking about conducting a revolution in a business as usual scenario.
I no, mean, we I'm need saying to conducting the revolution in a very ambitious way.
Okay. Business as usual, revolution?
Well, we are after the revolution from this point of view, because Greta in Sweden started in March last year, and a young generation is ready to join. I'm, as a matter of fact, in constant contact with one of the leaders, few leaders of such a movement in our country. They are fantastic young people, 15, 16, 17, and they expect a lot from us. If we can answer, especially in such a way like European Green Deal and deep energy transition, but they, young generation, youngest generation, they should answer as well. For example, Black Friday, consumption, overconsumption. You could see about, and I said to Michał Kiwerski, he's a leader of our movement after the Greta, and I told him, yeah, Michał, sorry, it was more or less 50% of people present in our shops was young people, 17, 16, 18. We should change our habits. Don't you think so? And he said, yes, of course. So we should start with your generation, as a matter of fact, as well. So, well, we are after revolution and we should go together in this revolution. We should cooperate with the youngest generation so we can survive, all of us.
Yeah, I totally agree that we need to talk much more with the younger generation, because also we need to close the gap. I think the younger generation are really putting this into the really drama thing, and really like this is important, and more looking into the problems in a bigger scale, which wake us up in order to make things. But then we also need to look into the solution and implement the solution. No? So how to close the gap together with the younger generations and really work on the solutions and the actions as soon as possible.
What do you think?
Well, I think it's exactly the same, but I don't think that the younger generation really expects more talking. I think that the younger generation, what it expects is action. And we see the younger generation being very angry. We have first lawsuits, for example, against federal governments where the younger generation say, you are not acting, you're willfully not acting to protect us in the future. So what they really expect is really action and not sense. So, but then again, we have the European Green Deal, which is something that the European Union wants to do, but then it gets no support, for example, from its international partners. So it's also a question of whether they expect more not only from one part of the world, but I guess they expect more from a general consensus, something that Mrs. Minister Emilevich said. But then is it possible, since we have, for example, President Trump saying that if you introduce the carbon border adjustment mechanism, then what we will do is introduce tariffs, right? So we have an international conflict, perhaps wanting to introduce climate change issues. So,
but maybe we need to tax the consumers, not the producers, when it comes to energy. I mean, maybe that would help if the final tax on energy emissions wouldn't be on the producers but on the consumers. Maybe we need to think about pooling resources in R&D. And instead of competing for technologies, maybe we should, you know, start a pan-European Manhattan project. I'm giving these slightly silly and probably impossible scenarios just to ask, don't you think that we're at a point where we need to start thinking about impossible scenarios?
Yeah, I think it is clear that we are at a very dangerous moment right now, and we are really on the precipice as a world of radical change that we don't really understand if we continue with business as usual. You know, if you look at what the science and the scientists are telling us, it is terrifying, and it can lead you straight into an, oh my God, we're doomed kind of, you know, posture. Because, you know, what we have seen is that with every new study and every new report, the predictions are more dire, and the change that's even already happening out in the world, and we know that there's a lag between when we put the emissions out and when we see their impact, but even what we're seeing already is happening so much faster, you know, changes in terms of melting of glaciers and all these other things that were expected to be happening decades from now are happening now. So, you know, things are deteriorating very fast. And if what is needed, based on what the science is telling us, and science doesn't care about politics or, you know, economics or anything, the laws of physics don't compromise. What the science is telling us we need is a very, very rapid reduction in emissions on a global basis starting, you know, 20 years ago, basically, but as a second choice now. And in fact, what we are seeing is exactly the opposite, which is that emissions are continuing to rise. So, you know, if we don't see a sea change really fast and a very rapid ramp up in political will and, you know, sort of a collective action, whether you want to call it a revolution or anything else, whatever it takes in terms of technology, innovation, politics, to start bringing those emissions down, if we don't have that kind of, you know, dramatic change fast, then I think we're going to see dramatic change, you know, whether we like it or not, in terms of temperatures continuing to rise and damaging weather events, whether it's storms, floods, droughts. We're already seeing that. And, you know, I think that the kinds of social and political change that will bring is, you know, very significant in its own right too, in terms of migration and conflict and scarcity of resources. So, you know, whether we like it or not, that is what we are facing. And so far, I think when you look around the world, our politicians and our leadership and our political systems are not up to the moment. You know, people like to talk about, oh, is there hope, or, you know, are we doomed? Hope is not just an emotion. It needs to be based on some kind of reality and some kind of action. And right now we're really not seeing that if you look around
politically. What do you guys think? Do you think I'm hysterical?
That
I'm hysterical, that I'm, you know, I'm talking about a looming catastrophe.
No, you are not. No, I don't think so. I mean, scientists say that this decade is absolutely crucial if we want to even to achieve the climate neutrality objectives by 2050. So if it doesn't start right now, then it may never start. And then we will rather have to face the consequences and pay for the damage. So I don't think you are hysterical. But I would just mention one thing. If you look at certain trends, for example, how many people live in cities and the evolution of how we live, actually, you know that it's at the moment already 80% of global GDP comes from cities. By half of this century, by middle of this century, 70% of population will live in cities, and many of them in Africa. By the way, there are also interesting demographic trends. Now Africa counts 1.5 billion people. By the end of this century, it will count 4 billion people. So obviously, if you don't look at those trends, you don't think, you don't see the how big challenge is ahead of us to make this planet simply livable for everyone under any geographical longitude. So it's basically a question of we have to realize the amount of the size of the challenge, but we have to start addressing it and without wasting time. And the EU is only, of course, a small part of this equation, because you need also the biggest emitters, obviously. Perhaps, there's not a panel to analyze what the Chinese may be doing or the Indians and so on, but obviously a lot of responses lie in Asia rather than in Europe. But what we can do is we can try to lead the way, and this is perhaps one of the most important things for the European Union to do in the coming decades. Thank you.
Yes, I wanted to share that this is what is the influence that we have at this moment. And we as a company, we are totally supporting the Green Deal in Europe, and we really want to contribute. And one of the things that I would ask is to involve more also the companies, the big companies in this Green Deal, to look for solutions, to look for how the legal solution should be. Because I think we need to do all of this together, and we need to work together. We have a big influence in the society, across the markets in Europe. So how to really involve all the partners into this one, no? And not only has to do governments and politics, but there are many other stakeholders that can really work towards that. So having ambitious goals is what we need in order to move as quick as possible and with impact, but then is how are we doing it together and putting solutions as soon as possible.
Okay, I think we're going to start taking questions. So if you have any questions, then I'm going to be looking at this part of the room. Joanna's going to be looking at that part of the room. So, and I think depending on how many questions there are, we're going to be taking them one by one, or we're going to be grouping them. Before that happens, because I don't see a show of hands at this point, so prepare your questions, please. And I wanted to ask you about what do you think could be a potential game changer when it comes to the global situation? I'm not talking about Europe, but what do you think would need to happen in order for China, India, the United States, Brazil, Australia to sort of own up and to say, okay, we need to do this, we need to get this done? Can you think of a... I can start you off. I think that if 30% of Florida goes underwater, then the United States would would really sort of figure this out and take a lot of people along. But what are the other, in the coming decade, what do you think, I mean, because quite obviously some terrible things will happen, I think.
Well, I mean, unfortunately, the science of how this works is that by the time that 30% of Florida is underwater, you know, further dramatic change is already baked in because there is this lag between when we emit the carbon and when it has its impact. But I think it's really hard to say what it takes, because I think that what we've started to see is that, you know, as this climate problem has risen up the agenda in terms of public awareness, it's also coincided with this, you know, really significant rise around the world of nationalism and, you know, a sort of more tribal kind of mentality of an us against them. You know, particularly in the United States, we're seeing this with Trump and the Republicans, you know, really doubling down on a refusal to engage with the science of climate change and the change that is needed, you know, regardless of what happens sort of out in the world. So I think when you talk about, like, would 30% of Florida going underwater actually make people change their politics or change their policy, I think in a sense that underestimates the degree to which we all view everything that happens through our own pre-existing lenses, and what might appear to, you know, those of us who are engaged with the science as a confirmation of what we expect and what may be to follow would not necessarily be taken that way. You know, a lot of the storms and severe weather that have already happened in the United States get just sort of dismissed as, you know, wildfires are caused, Trump said, because we're not taking proper care of, you know, trimming back dry fuel in the forests, which, you know, there's some grain of truth in that, but it's obviously missing a much bigger picture. So, you know, I'm afraid that if we wait for sort of more catastrophes to happen, we're already in a situation where these impacts are turning us against one another rather than bringing us together to actually take some action to solve and prevent them.
Let me say, generally speaking, I would like to continue what Mr. Director Daniel Dovgledic said a few minutes ago. Paying for the damages will be much more costly than to avoid them. That's a very important signal for all of us, because is a serious danger in front of us, and we feel it. And from the point of view of global issue, Europe itself cannot change a lot. We are responsible for 8% of, without Great Britain, we are responsible for 8% of emission. And if we go so far as we want to go in the next 10 years, it will be 3-4 less. And we need 30 or 40 less in the global scale. So our obligation is not to, as a matter of fact, to help directly the situation on our planet, but to give an excellent example for others that we could still keep our work jobs, our jobs, attractive jobs for young generation, and prosperity, and thanks to innovation, sorry to say that. But it's very important to give such a signal, otherwise nobody would like go to the same direction. And what could be dangerous for us if we, in the first step, 2030, we say 50% of greenhouse gas emission reduction in 10 years. Okay, but Greens sometimes say 75 will be better. Of course, but it's impossible, simply speaking, to go so far, because it's a big danger that we will lose as European Union, and not to give a good example for others. So it's much better to be more moderate in the first step, because the first step is, well, very strong one. Well, on the basis of IPCC, International Panel of Climate Change, cooperating with COP, each COP, they say in second half of 21st century, our planet should be more climate neutral. And we, European Union, would like to be at the beginning of this period, the beginning of second half of the century. So we are fast enough, but not to go too fast if we want really to win and to give an excellent example for others, for China, for United States, for Russia, for India. That's our obligation today.
Well, I don't think anybody's in danger of going too fast right now.
Okay.
Can I just add one thing?
Yeah. Sure.
I'm pretty sure this is not really the full answer, but certainly one very important part of the answer is, I agree here with Prime Minister Buzek, is we can show that we are still very competitive and we are gaining in competitiveness. While at the same time taking ambitious steps in climate action. And there are also economic data which can prove you that. I'm not going to go into this, but there is also, I think, an important element. Those countries like India or China, if they want to become, well, China is already becoming very fast the developed country, and of course India is also a very potential beneficiary of fast development. And if they want to achieve that, they will want to trade with others, with Europe and with the US and so on equal terms, I think trade will be a very big encouragement. Trade, investment, so economic rationale will be a very important argument, because we will need to have more or less the same standards, otherwise it won't work. So the trade policy will be a very early interesting example of what happens when the European Commission presents their ideas for this relationship between trade and carbon tax.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, questions. I saw a question over there. Thank you. Over there, I don't know if there's, yeah.
There's one.
And there's a question over there.
Small provocative question to Prime Minister Buzek. Because after or behind every big strategic scenario, there is, I'm here. I mean, Gregor Schroeder.
Okay.
Behind every big strategic plan, there are so-called baby steps that should be encountered. And talking about the credibility of the European Green Deal, we see the European elites discussing it, while at the same time every month the entire staff is moving from Brussels to Strasbourg, 12 times a year, or even two additional sessions. Did you ever calculate the carbon footprint, which is entitled to it? So, I mean, I imagine 99% of staff is actually using planes at the same time. So, wouldn't it be better to start with the little baby steps among the European parliamentarians who are now discussing Green Deal before we will talk big things that we are discussing here?
I think we're going to take another question over there, and I understand there's a question behind me.
Just please introduce yourself.
Thank you. Będę mówił po polsku, przepraszam za to gości anglojęzycznych. Moje nazwisko Łukasz Stępniak, jestem dziennikarzem portalu wiadomościhandlowe.pl, a chciałbym odnieść się do przewijającego się takiego motywu związanego z młodym pokoleniem, które jest pełne energii, żeby zmieniać świat i ufne w to, że jest go w stanie zmienić i zreformować. Chciałbym przytoczyć taki tekst z naszego portalu. Green Generation nie istnieje, młodzi Polacy nie interesują się ekologią. I tylko kilka zdań. Według badania Green Generation przeprowadzonego przez Mobile Institute, Polacy raczej nie śledzą informacji o stanie środowiska. Tematem tym interesuje się jedynie 32% badanych. Szczególnie niskie zainteresowanie widać wśród młodych osób, odpowiednio 24% wśród nastolatków i 14% w grupie 19-24. Informacje dotyczące stanu i zmian środowiska naturalnego śledzi też jedynie 23% mężczyzn w porównaniu do 43% kobiet. Okazuje się też, że najmłodsi przebadani Polacy w wieku do 24 lat są wobec zagadnień ekologii jeszcze bardziej obojętni. Zainteresowanie stanem środowiska wykazuje 24% nastolatków i 14% osób w wieku 19-24. Młodzi ludzie nie uważają też, że mamy do czynienia z globalnym ociepleniem. Odpowiednio 28 i 33% osób zdaje sobie z tego sprawę. Polska to kraj zagrożony ekologicznie, uważa z kolei 25%.
Przepraszam, przerwę panu, bo mam wrażenie, już. Że już jakby.
Tak. To już było ostatnie zdanie. Czy nie za dużą ufność pokładamy w młodym pokoleniu? I prawdę mówiąc, czy nie został popełniony, czy błędem pierworodnym nie są rodzice tak naprawdę i to, co dzieje się w tej chwili w domach, między innymi Polaków. Dziękuję.
I'm going to translate this question in a moment. We'll round them up. And are we going to take another question?
Yeah, let's take another question right over there in the back. Do we have the microphone?
Thank you. Krzysztof Bolesta, former Polityka Insight and now running a NGO promoting clean air. I just wanted to ask you if it's possible to move anywhere and without politicians growing a pair, really, because this is what we need, is a revolution. And everyone, I think, not only in Poland, but in many places in Europe, says that, well, it will cost a lot of money, we can do it maybe costless, someone will pay for it, not us. I think Green Revolution will cost money and there'll be new taxes. And without this, we cannot move forward. So how we can make sure that the politicians actually realize we need new policies, new regulations that will cost money. Thank you.
Okay, so we have three questions. One is directed specifically to Prime Minister Buzek about commuting to Strasbourg. The second question was basically summing this up, looking at actual research about young people and how much they care about climate change. Basically, the thesis behind it was that they don't. I'd say it was between, from what I noted down, between sort of 25% to 35% of young people who basically care about climate change. And the question summed up to, if young people don't care, is this not is the problem not with their parents, and is it not the parents that we should be focusing on? And aren't we, don't we believe that young people will do much more than they're actually going to do? And then the third question you heard. So maybe we're going to start with the Strasbourg question.
Well, let me, if I may, answer in a general way. It's necessary to create a competitive free market economy, but to avoid something which was so dangerous in the last decades. I mean, greed-free market. And we could see it in, Africa or in South America. And the result from the environmental point of view was horrible. And we should create everything what means competitivity of our economy. But on the other hand, we should have a quite strict regulation from the level of European Commission, European Union, agreed between in the trialogues, of course, with the member states at the end. So having a regulation on the basis of law, we should create all the directives and all the law pieces in the next few years to know that we are going step by step on the basis of European law. So in this case, I think that we can keep our competitive free market, competitivity of our economy, and on the other hand, to fulfill our expectations. We had such an idea 20 years ago in, as I remember, in Lisbon. Yeah, it was Lisbon strategy. Mm-hmm. Fantastic, but so-called open coordination. What it meant, that each member state was responsible for spending money for innovation, was completely failure. So we should take care about such open coordination. Now it should be European law on the European Green Deal, and then go step by step in the climate neutrality 2050 as European Union, as a whole European Union, and of course to create free market, well, it's absolutely not too much regulation from the point of view of free market economy, because it will be killing for the economy as it is.
Right, do you want to take one of the other questions? Parents versus children, and do we put too much faith in the young generation?
From my point of view, I think we should not just put, the responsibility on the younger generations. The ones who can make the change and who are really responsible for it is us, you know. But they can be a little bit a wake-up call, and it's good that they are starting to have this awareness. And I hope it will grow, and they are really challenging us even more. But for sure, the ones who need to take the decisions and the solutions and the actions is us and our generation, and that's what we see in the consumers. No, is the ones that have the power to also make and ask companies to make the change. So yeah, so I totally agree. We cannot put it on them.
Yeah, I agree with that. And to the question from Chris Ballesta in the back, I think it is true that there is going to be a lot of political leadership that's required here if we are going to step up and meet this challenge. I mean, there's a lot of talk about opportunities in the green economy and innovation, and that is all true. You know, China is a great example of, they decided to become a leader in manufacturing solar panels, and they did, brought the price down of those 90% for the rest of us. They're trying to do the same thing now with electric vehicles, and they see it as an opportunity. But it is also true, I think Chris is right, that there are going to be upfront costs to the kind of, especially very rapid transformation of our economies and our energy systems and our manufacturing systems that are required now. And there are going to be winners and losers there. And I think that in the same way that our economic and our corporate systems are not set up to deal with long-term challenges, they're set up to worry about, you know, the profits in the next quarter and their stock price, our political systems are not set up to deal with these kinds of long-term challenges. You know, we're seeing all over the world, politicians always more worried about the next election than you know, what's going to happen decades from now and what future generations are going to be faced with. And I think that the climate crisis has really brought that sort of poor fit to the fore, because I don't know if there's ever been a time in the past where we've been faced with such a moment where the decisions made now are going to have, you know, generational consequences, and what we do now, the effects will be felt, you know, far long after all of us in this room are gone, and even after our children are gone. You know, the climate moves on a millennial time scale. And, you know, what is it going to take for politicians to step up and show that kind of leadership? I don't know the answer to that, but I do think that it's clear that that's what we need, and it's not going to be easy.
Well, I think in Poland you should more care about old people, because it's not a country for young people, as if we look at the statistics, actually. It's more old people country, but anyway. That was obviously just a joke. And now, just for those who are tweeting, and, you know, please put it in the brackets that it's a joke, okay? now, just to say two things. First of all, I think that the way to talk to, well, the way to talk to young people is simply that all that we are discussing here is very much about how the jobs will look like and how the labor market will look like, and actually how their life will look like. Because I mentioned this issue about cities, because it is, I think it's actually very easy to imagine what it means for quality of life, for how life will be different when everything will be concentrated in cities, all economic activity. That will have, of course, without very effective climate action, making those places sustainable, making transport green, managing waste and all that, those places will be simply it will be impossible to survive there normally. So I think it's very important that that we talk not really just about what we do, you know, with climate, that people can associate with clouds or whether it rains or whether it's sunny or not, but we talk about actually how this transforms society and the way we live, because it will be a huge transformation. So either you take the steps necessary and you try to sort of influence it, or you simply resign, and then it will hit you at some moment in your life anyway, whether you lose a job or whether you simply are, your house is flooded and you have nowhere to go. And so I think that this is very much the real argument. It's not just about climate.
Just very shortly, I have a last question to Prime Minister Buzek. Shortly, what should we expect from Poland and the June European Council? And what do you expect from this meeting that Minister Emilewicz announced of the group of countries, friends of the industry, before the Council?
Well, the first issue, the most important, Poland should take part in the big European project, European Green Deal, and the most important slogan within the European Green Deal, of course, is climate neutrality to 2050. And we should take part in such a big topic, and not to avoid engagement, because if we dream of, let's say, climate cohesion policy, not so much territorial, but it's also territorial cohesion policy. We should be inside of the whole program. And we will have some problems in European Parliament in next few months. I've got on the table the regulation on just transition fund, for example. And there are very serious questions from the Greeks or Bulgarian colleagues. Why Poland, with the main beneficiary of the idea of just transition fund? And this idea, as a matter of fact, let's say, was constructed in European Parliament 1 year ago.
It's your baby.
On my amendment to the multi-annual financial framework. And it's a big problem for us. How to explain that we would like to have, I don't know, at the beginning, originally 2 billion euro, but at the end, if you multiply everything, 100 billion zloty for Poland, for energy transition, for climate transition, generally speaking. Why, if you are not involved in the program as a country? So it is not necessary waiting until June, by my opinion, just to take decision immediately and to say the whole public opinion to Europe, yes, we are together with you. And let me say, which is very important, first step is very important, because we should not lose the first step as European Union, 2030, and 50% reduction. Great, in comparison with 20. We started 2007. 13 years, 20%, 13 years. And now we would like to jump from 20 to 50 in 10 years. It's not easy, it's enough, 50%. Not 55, not 60, not 65, not 75. Going back to the Greens idea. And to keep this way in very strong position with European Commission, European institutions, I I'm sure that we can be successful.
Okay, I think we're going to be wrapping up. I think only a madman would try to sort of sum this discussion up. I wrote basically 3 points. I think we all agree that we need a revolution. I understand that at least part of the panel believes the glass is half full and that the European Green Deal is a good first step towards leading the way to a better future. And I think most people would agree that politicians need to step up and to own the situation. And we cannot forget about societies and businesses, because if people won't pressure businesses and politicians, then governments and businesses won't do this for us. So I think it's basically up to us and up to making this change happen. So thank you very much, Beth Gardner, Karolina Garcia Gomez, Jerzy Buzek, Mikołaj Dawgilewicz, and let's have lunch. Thank you.
Thank you.